So we'll talk about memory resource management today, and we'll start with cache management. So most of today will be dedicated to shared cache management in multi-core architectures. These are some required readings. I required the first one, which has had a lot of impact in the field since it's been published. It was published in Micro 2006, and we'll cover that. That's the idea of utility-based cache partitioning. But there are some others that we will also try to cover toward the end. So basically, we'll talk about shared resource design for multi-core systems. Now that you've seen multi-core cache coherence and caches earlier, let's talk about how to do the sharing between them. This is a cartoonish picture that I showed when I talked about the memory system in earlier lectures. Basically, if you look at this memory system, cores are a small part. Right? And I know this is a cartoon, but if you actually do the studies, cores are actually a smaller part of the entire node. Most of the memory system is really shared across the cores. Shared caches, shared interconnects, other shared caches, shared memory controllers, shared main memory, shared disks, dot, dot, dot. So we're going to talk about that sharing. But this is a very fundamental concept, right? The idea of resource sharing is instead of dedicating a hardware resource or a software resource, but we're going to talk about hardware here, a hardware resource to a hardware context, allow multiple contexts to share it and use it. There are many resources, for example, functional units, pipelines, caches, buses, memory. You can apply this concept to any resource that you have, including software resources, actually. Why would you like to do it? Anybody has a single word guess? Just want a single word. Come on, it's not that late. Okay, two words are fine too. What is this most important reason for doing this? Why would you want to share something? Exactly. It's more efficient to actually share it, right? It improves your utilization. It improves your efficiency. Otherwise, it could be very expensive. And that could lead to throughput. Basically, when a resource is left idle by one thread, another thread can use it, right? And there are also other reasons where efficiency comes from. No need to replicate shared data, for example, right? If you actually have private caches, you replicate the shared data across them. Whereas if you have a shared cache, there's only one copy of data. And there's another reason. It reduces communication latency, right? Again, for example, shared data is kept in the same cache for SMT processors. As a result, you don't need to communicate between the caches. And it's also compatible with the shared memory model, right? If you're sharing a resource, it's conceptually shared memory is really a huge shared resource. Of course, conceptual versus implementation is different, right? You can actually have a shared global address space that's distributed across nodes. We're talking about hardware resource sharing here. So the downside is, well, I guess I could have asked you, but it results in contention for shared resources. If you have something shared, there's always contention, right? That's true for the world resources also, right? When a resource is not idle, another thread now cannot use it. If the space is occupied by one thread, another thread needs to reoccupy it. That happens in the cache, for example, right? The first one happens in buses or interconnects, for example. By the way, you can share both bandwidth and space. In a sense, you can share both time and space. In caches, you have space. And you also have time, right? When you need to access the cache, if you have limited bandwidth, you need to share that. Basically, this contention sometimes reduces each thread's performance or some thread's performance without affecting some other. Sometimes it reduces all thread's performance, as we will see. And thread performance can actually be worse than when the thread is run alone. And this can, of course, degrade system performance also as a result. The second effect is this eliminates performance isolation, right? If you get inconsistent performance across nodes. If you have actually a dedicated resource, let's say a dedicated cache to a core, you know what you're getting. Whereas if you actually have shared space, then you may be sharing it with different cores that have different characteristics, that are running applications with different characteristics. And we will see that. Thread performance now depends on what's co-executing or what's co-running with the thread. And clearly, based on this, uncontrolled sharing degrades quality of service. And a lot of some of what we will talk about will be about quality of service, especially in the next lecture. And this can cause unfairness or starvation. So I had given you an example in an earlier lecture. If you actually have a cache that prioritizes, let's say a memory controller that prioritizes streaming access patterns that keep hitting in the row buffer, then another thread that has a random access pattern will get denied service for a while. Right? That's the same thing will happen in cache. We'll talk about fair cache sharing today. Which means that because of these disadvantages, you need to somehow efficiently and fairly utilize these shared resources. You need to have mechanisms for this. So let me give you an example. This is an example from a paper that we will very briefly cover. This is one of the earlier papers actually on cache sharing that focuses on fairness. It is a paper that is a nice idea, and I'll recommend you to read it, but I'm not going to require it. But if you look at two cores that are sharing a cache, if this application is running alone, let's say it occupies this much cache space in the L2. Whereas if this application is running alone, let's say it occupies this much cache space, more than half in each. When they're sharing, it turns out this application occupies the same cache space that it's occupying before, but this application now has a lot reduced cache space. As a result, the second thread's throughput can be significantly reduced due to that unfair cache sharing, especially if it's utilizing the cache well, right? So that's the basic problem with shared resources. And you can imagine memory bandwidth over here also. In fact, if this blue thread over here, thread one, for example, is actually streaming through memory, bringing in gigabytes and gigabytes of data and not reusing it much, it's basically clearing the cache very nicely for another application that may actually have very good locality in the cache. That's basically a big problem. For example, you can imagine a thread. You're doing video processing. You're actually watching a video. Is it a good idea to bring all of that data into the cache, into a shared cache, where you have another application that's running that's more critical for your performance? So it's good to think about this. It's good to think about the applications that may be causing these patterns. OK. So I'll talk about quality of service and shared resource management later on. But let's talk about why is unpredictable performance bad? Do you guys want unpredictable performance or lack of quality of service? Probably not, right? So why is it bad? First of all, it makes, well, I guess this may not be the top reason. It makes users' life difficult. But it also makes programmers' life difficult, right? If you're a programmer, now you can optimize your program nicely for an architecture. You run it, you get good performance alone. But now, in the field, that program runs together with some other application. And because there is no guarantee for predictable performance, your performance tanks. You've done all these cache optimizations. All of it becomes null because some other application clears the cache, right? Because it brings in lots of data. So it makes performance optimization much more difficult also if you don't have some guarantees in terms of what you get. Clearly, this may be the first most important one. It causes discomfort to user, right? One important program can starve if you don't have guarantees. And there are many examples from shared software resources. There used to be a time at Microsoft, there were a lot of shared software resources, Excel, Word, Many programs had the shared software base, and there were shared locks in these resources. When one program was accessing the disk, another program actually couldn't access disk. If you actually used Excel at some point, I had this problem many times. If PowerPoint was actually writing something to the disk, Excel wouldn't be able to access the disk. So this is one example of a shared resource at the software level, right? And it caused a lot of discomfort to me at the time. Similarly, you can have similar issues with hardware also. You could have a hardware issue at the storage controller also. So the third issue is that this makes system management difficult too. Basically, if you're a system designer or a system operator, let's say, how do you enforce a service level agreement, data center operator, let's say? How do you enforce a service level agreement when you don't have a hardware that is not controllable? Well, one thing you can do is you can run an application alone in a single core, even though you have a 1,000-core machine, right? But then it goes back to an inefficient utilization of the resources. So you're losing something by doing that. OK, so I've started with resource sharing. But clearly, there is the opposite end, which is the partitioning of the resource, completely partitioning, which you said was very expensive. And I agree. Basically, sharing improves throughput. You get better utilization of space. It's cheaper. You amortize the cost of the resource. Partitioning, on the other hand, provides performance isolation. You could partition the caches and you get good performance. You could partition the memory. That becomes even more expensive now. Now you get dedicated space. The question many people have asked, and we are going to ask in this lecture, is can we get the benefits of both somehow? And the idea is design the shared resources such that they're efficiently utilized, controllable, and partitionable. Now, how is it partitioned will be the subject of what we will talk about a lot in this lecture. Basically, the goal will be no wasted resource, hopefully. You efficiently utilize it. And also a quality of service mechanisms for threats, where quality of service may mean many things, actually. I haven't defined it over here. OK? So let's take a look at some shared hardware resources before we go into the caches in detail. This is just to give you an idea of what is shared, basically. Memory subsystem. And the discussion will not be specific to multi-core, really, although multi-core is very dominant. But multi-thread processors are very dominant today, too. A lot of multi-core processors have multi-threading in them, too. So memory subsystem is shared in these processors, non-private caches, interconnects, memory controllers, buses, banks. Everything beyond the non-private caches is shared, basically. I/O subsystem is also shared. We're not going to talk about that. But DMA controllers, Ethernet controllers, I/O controllers, they're all shared. And in multi-threaded systems, processor is also shared. The pipeline resources, L1 caches, sometimes reorder buffer is also shared and partitioned. We're not going to talk about this over here, but this becomes an even more severe problem in multi-threaded processors. So we're going to focus on the non-private caches, mainly in this lecture, and memory controllers in the next lecture. OK, so let's take a look at the two options. Basically, how does the cache hierarchy change in a multi-core system? Well, you need to have caches for different cores. And I'm going to assume that L1 caches are private. And many systems today, L2 caches are also moving to be private. Really, L3 caches are being shared. But anyway, without loss of generality, we can assume that L2 caches could be shared or private. So private cache belongs to a core. A shared block can be in multiple caches now. Basically, you need to replicate that block. Whereas if you have a shared cache is shared by multiple cores. Now, there are many advantages and disadvantages associated with it. Well, I guess I'm going to give you a lot of them. Basically, the first is efficient utilization. We already talked about it, right? You get high effective capacity if you actually share the caches. This is the advantage of shared caches over private caches. Because now you can actually enable dynamic partitioning of available cache space. Whereas if you think about the partitioning approach or private cache approach, it's really statically partitioned, right? Here now you can dynamic utilize. Basically, there is no fragmentation due to static partitioning. If a core needs, let's say you have 1 megabyte private cache with a 4-core system, you take it together, make it 4 megabytes. A core that needs more than 1 megabyte now can get more space. And a core that needed only 64 kilobytes doesn't waste the entire 1 megabyte now. Right? That's the beauty of sharing. Easier to maintain coherence. John covered coherence in the last lecture. If you have a shared cache, coherence problem goes away, right? In fact, if all caches were shared, then there would be no coherence problem, right? Because there would be only one copy of data anywhere in the system. And finally, the communication also reduces. Shared data and locks, basically synchronization primitives, do not ping pong between the caches. If a cache writes to a location, that data is in only one location right now, right? So shared caches ease coherence quite a bit and reduce the communication. There's also higher effective capacity because the shared data doesn't have multiple copies again, right? So that's important, and especially when you have a lot of sharing across different threads in a multi-threaded application. So there are, of course, disadvantages also. Because of sharing, now you can have slower access, right? Because now you're sharing a 4 megabyte space, whereas you could have dedicated a 1 megabyte thing and accessed it directly from one core. Right? The other disadvantage we've already talked about, now cores incur conflict misses due to other cores' accesses. Now you have interference, right? You get new types of misses that didn't exist before. And some cores, as I showed you earlier, can destroy the hit rate of other cores. And quality of service becomes a problem, basically. OK. So we'll assume that we have shared caches for now. But we may revisit that later on. Because one approach would be sharing, starting with shared caches and actually partitioning it nicely, dynamically. But the other approach could be starting with private caches and adding some more sharing to it. Let's start with the first approach. Basically, if what you have today is free-for-all sharing. What I mean by that, if you just extend a single core system and apply the same policies, what you get is really free-for-all sharing. The placement and replacement policies for the cache are the same as single core, usually LRU or some variant of LRU. It's not aware of threads or applications, which means that an incoming block evicts a block regardless of which threads the block belongs to. There's no consideration of that, right? As a result, you get this unfairness problem. There are many problems, basically. You can actually get inefficient utilization of the cache, right? Because LRU may not be the best policy. You can actually now destroy all of your cache utilization even though there may be applications that actually would have benefited from the cache, right? Always think the streaming application example that destroys the performance of an application with a good locality. And not all applications benefit equally from the same amount of cache. If you're doing free-for-all sharing, just using LRU, least recently used replacement, you might prioritize those that do not benefit. Again, the streaming application is a good example. So how do we handle shared caches? As a result of these, you get reduced performance and reduced fairness. Right. We'll talk about two things, basically controlling cache sharing. And there are two approaches, as I said earlier. You can design shared caches, but control the amount of cache allocated to different cores. And the second is you can design private caches, but then add some more sharing to it. And we'll talk about that also. And this is called, you can actually, if a core needs a little bit more cache space, it spills from its private cache to other private caches. And some cores may receive because they don't need the cache that are associated with that core. The second is more efficient cache utilization. This is good in general, but it becomes a much bigger problem in multi-core, because multi-core cache becomes a much more valuable space. And if you more efficiently utilize it, you reduce the requirement for the memory bandwidth as well. Basically, how do you minimize the wasted cache space? By keeping out useless blocks. So if you're streaming through memory, maybe it's a good idea not to cache those things, right? By keeping in the cache blocks that have the maximum benefit. So the idea of utility-based cache partitioning will try to achieve that maximum benefit. And by minimizing redundant data. So if you have actually useless data that is replicated, or maybe useful data that's replicated across the entire cache, can you more efficiently encode that? Well, if we get to it, we'll talk about cache compression. So these are some examples. There's been a lot of work in this area, and some processors actually implement some of the mechanisms. I'll talk about it when I get to it. But I'll pick and choose some papers that I believe cover some of the fundamental approaches to the problem. We'll first start with the utility-based cache partitioning. And this is some of the more efficient cache utilization examples. Let's talk about controlling shared caches. Any questions so far? This all makes sense, right? You can control shared caches in hardware and software. So we'll talk about both. And hopefully at the end, we'll contrast hardware versus software approaches. Let's start with hardware. I'll give you the idea of utility-based cache partitioning. Basically, here the goal is to maximize system throughput. How many instructions per cycle you can get out of the system, or maybe how many jobs per cycle. The observation is that not all threads or applications benefit equally from caching. Simple LRU replacement mechanisms are not good for system throughput, as I discussed earlier, right? And the idea is very simple, basically. Somehow figure out which application benefits more from the cache space and allocate more cache space to applications that obtain more benefit from the cache space. Make sense? And the high-level idea, again, can be applied to other resources as well. The specifics you'll need to figure out. You can apply it to memory bandwidth, for example. You can apply it to main memory capacity. You can apply it to other kind of shared resources. And these are the papers that actually discussed it. This is the paper that first introduced the idea, but it had a not very feasible implementation. And this paper actually made it much more feasible to implement in real hardware. So let's talk about how it's done. Basically, we'll define the marginal utility of a cacheway. And that's basically, this is the utility of allocating going from allocating B ways to an application, going from B ways to A ways, basically, or maybe A ways to B ways. Which one has more misses? This is a miss rate reduction that you would get if you allocate some more ways to the application. Let's give you let's take a look at it more pictorially. This is actually real results, number of ways allocated for this application from a 16-way 1 megabyte cache. And we're going to assume that you're actually allocating on a way granularity, and you have 16 ways. This application, AppLoo, it looks like it doesn't have any utility, right? It's a very low utility application. If you give one more way to the application, your miss rate on the y-axis doesn't change. So you probably don't want to allocate a lot of ways to this application, because it's not using more ways. Why? You can imagine, it may be streaming through memory, right? It always has the same miss rate. It doesn't have good reuse. Another application, TWolf again, in this case, it has high utility. If you look at the curve, it keeps going down, right? Another application, it saturates. Basically, its utility is saturating. After some point, its miss rate stabilizes. So the idea of utility-based cache partitioning is figuring out points in these curves such that you maximize the utility or minimize the miss rate, let's say, across the entire system. Let me give you one example. Basically, again, the same kind of graph over here. This is miss rate, misses per 1,000 instructions. That's a good metric for a miss rate because it tells you how many misses you see across a number of instructions. And this number of ways allocated to two different applications, eQuake, a relatively streaming application, and VPR. Actually, this is a place on route application. So this has good utility. If you do LRU, if you do free-for-all sharing, you may get something like this. Free-for-all sharing doesn't do way-based sharing clearly, right? It allocates blocks on a per-set basis. But you may end up at a point that looks like this, basically. A good half of the cache is here, and almost half of the cache is here. But if you want to do utility-based cache partitioning, this is actually where you would go. Because if you have a partitioning mechanism that considers how much benefit each application would get, it would stop giving more cache to this eQuake application until it reaches this knee of the curve, right? But it would keep giving more cache to this VPR application because it benefits from the cache. So eQuake would get only 3 ways of the cache, and VPR would get 13 ways of the cache. Make sense? That's the idea. How do you design a mechanism that does this, basically? Well, I'll talk about it quickly, but it's your assigned reading, so you can actually go into more detail by reading it. There are 3 things that you need to do. First, you need to figure out the utility of different applications, and that's one of the big contributions of this paper. Second, you need to figure out how to partition the cache. You need to have a partitioning algorithm. And you need to have a mechanism to enforce the different partitions, right? Now, even though I talk about utility-based cache partitioning in particular, any kind of partitioning mechanism requires 3 things, right? Figuring out what are the inputs to the partitioning algorithm, how to partition, and how to enforce the partitioning, right? You really need those 3 things to do cache partitioning in a shared cache. So how do you actually do the utility? Basically, for each core, you can simulate the LRU policy using ATD. Basically, what do you really need? You need to get the miss rate of a core as if it had n number of ways. Now, how do you get that when you're running together with other applications? Well, you need to kind of emulate or simulate. What would your miss rate be if you had the cache to yourself? If you had 0 ways, 1 ways, 2 ways, 3 ways, 4 ways, dot, dot, dot. And the idea is to have an auxiliary tag directory that is separate from the main tag directory, because main tag directory is shared. But this auxiliary tag directory is just for this application. And you keep track of how many misses you would get at different positions. This is position 0. This is MRU position versus LRU position, position 0 versus position 15. Now, LRU is a stack algorithm, right? Because it basically is really like a stack. When you hit in the MRU position, you can increment these counters. And those counters would tell you how many misses you would eliminate if you had one more way. Basically, hit counts that you have in these different ways for the LRU would tell you what your utility would be. So for example, if you want to get the hit count of 2 ways, you would figure out how many hits you would get at the MRU position, and then how many hits you would get at the second most MRU position, and then add them up. That gives you the number of hits you would have gotten if you had only two ways. Now let me give you an example of this. Maybe this was too much, but let's take a look at this pictorially again. You have number of ways per set. This is the number of misses that you get. And this is the hit counter. Basically, these are the hit counters that you add for each position in the tag directory, MRU to LRU. And you have four counters. And these are the results that you would get with these four counters. And this is the misses that you have. You don't hit for 25 of them. Now, if you want to figure out how many misses you would get, let's say how many misses you would get if you allocated only, I guess, three ways to this application, it's really 25 plus 10, 35. Does that make sense? Because you wouldn't have this third way, fourth way. As a result, you wouldn't get the 10 misses. If you want to figure out how many misses you would get if you allocated only two ways, way 0 and way 1, then the misses you would get is 25 plus 10 plus 15, which is 50, I guess. And that's exactly what this graph plots. Make sense? So by having these counters associated with each LRU way, you can figure out how many misses you would get. But of course, you need to have an auxiliary tag directory on a per application basis. So how do you do that? Does that make sense? Is that clear to everyone? You may need to think about it a little bit. But basically, the problem is you need to have a tag directory for each application. And that may be costly, right? It's basically a tag store per application. It turns out what you can do is you can sample the sets. If you have 16,000 sets, you don't need to have 16,000 entries and make a decision based on that. You can just say, oh, I'm going to associate a separate auxiliary tags associated with some randomly chosen sets over here. I'm going to look at what kind of hits and misses I'm getting over there. This is called dynamic set sampling. You can actually read this paper. This is the paper that introduced the idea. This way, you can actually summarize the behavior you're getting across the sets of a large cache with relatively low hardware cost. If you look at the paper, it's about less than 2 kilobytes over here. Make sense? So sampling is a good technique in general if you want to reduce the hardware cost. OK, so that's basically how you do the utility monitoring. How do you figure out the number of misses you would get for an application if you had n ways allocated to it? Now, if you have that information, how do you partition the cache? Basically, one algorithm would be to evaluate all possible partitions and select the best. So if you have two cores, you can have you can assign A ways to core 1 and 16 minus A ways to core 2. And you can figure out how many hits you would get for different values of A based on these utility counters. Right? And select an A that maximizes the total number of hits in the cache. Make sense? And you can do the partitioning some interval. In the paper, it does every 5 million cycles. But you can see that this is a little bit complex, right? What if you don't have only two cores? What if you have 16 cores and 48 ways? Well, we'll take a look at that. Now, OK, let's assume that this you can do this. We're going to get back to this in a little bit. How do you now do the partitioning itself? What are the hardware mechanisms? So this paper uses way partitioning in particular. Basically, partitioning granularity is on the order of ways. You can give one way to an application, but you cannot give smaller than a way. Well, why? It makes sense, because the counters are associated with ways, right? That's how you get the good utility measures. This doesn't do the block-based partitioning. Block-based partitioning is much more fine granularity. You allocate this block to this application, this block to another application. Much more finer granularity. But figuring out the utility of a block is a lot more difficult, because how do you figure out that utility if you have LRU? OK, so way partitioning support, you need to have this. What is the support that's needed? Each line has some core ID bits. And by the way, this is a paper written by Intel, Ravi Iyer, in ICS. It's called CacheQOS. It's really the precursor of Intel Haswell's implementation of quality of service mechanism. Intel Haswell last year introduced quality of service mechanisms to partition the cache across different cores. And that paper actually talks about the precursors to it. I would recommend looking into that. So you can think about it. This paper was written in 2004, and the hardware actually was introduced in 2014, let's say. So it takes about 10 years or so. So, okay, going back, each line, you need to be able to distinguish between different lines, who they belong to, you need to have core ID bits, clearly. And on a miss, we want to count the number of ways occupied in the set by the miss-causing application. Now, you have ways given, how many ways are allocated to this application. You know that from the previous partitioning algorithm. And you know how many ways this application is occupying. If the application is occupying less ways than it's given, now you can evict the LRU line from another application, right, to give more ways to this application. Otherwise, you need to evict a line from this application because it's already occupying more ways or equal ways as it's given. Does that make sense? This is pretty simple, actually. But you need to have hardware support for this. Now let's take a look at this performance of this. I'll go through these next slides relatively quickly because you can read the paper for the performance in general. But very quickly, there are metrics to evaluate multi-core performance. And I'd recommend you take a look at them. One of them is, for example, this throughput, IPC throughput metric. You have IPC summed up. And there are advantages and disadvantages to different metrics, clearly. This is something you will need to think about when you're actually evaluating multi-core system performance, when you're running multiple different applications. If you do this, and if this is your performance metric, this can be unfair to an application that has low IPCs, right? Because you can improve this metric by prioritizing an application that has higher IPCs. So you've got to be careful with the performance metrics. The second, this one is actually used a lot in computer architecture studies. It's called weighted speedup. This is basically a sum of slowdowns, if you will, the sum of IPC shared divided by IPC alone for each application. Make sense? That's kind of slowdown of each application summed up. You can think of it as a competitive ratio also, if you know the concept of competitive ratio. But this, people have shown that this correlates with throughput, system throughput. And the last one is the harmonic mean fairness, or harmonic mean speedup metric. And this is really the harmonic mean of the slowdowns over here. And this was shown to balance more fairness and performance. But if you're interested, I can give you more references related to this. But I guess the takeaway is be careful with what metrics you're examining. So here, this is weighted speedup over here. And if you look at the results that you get, I'll very quickly focus on this average results. If you do LRU, free-for-all sharing across these two core workloads, you get some performance. If you actually do private caches, basically partition statically, health and health, actually that's a little bit worse than free-for-all sharing. So free-for-all sharing, in this case, on average, is a little bit better. But it's not always the case. Sometimes private caches are better, as you can see over here. Sometimes free-for-all sharing is better, as you can see over here, especially when you have more memory intensity over here. But if you look at utility-based cache partitioning, it does improve performance significantly. I think it's about 20% over here. And you can actually look at the IPC results. So there are cases where performance improves for one application without degrading the performance of another application. Why does this happen? Well, the other application may not be utilizing the cache well, right? Basically, you're taking away space from an application that's not using the cache anyway. That's why that kind of thing can happen, right? In other cases, of course, you degrade the performance of one application at the expense of an, improving, or at the benefit of improving the performance of another application. Right? OK. Any questions? Any thoughts? It's a cool idea. Not so. It's a simple idea. And people are thinking about how to actually implement it in good ways. But let's talk about some problems, because I think a lot of what I'll discuss actually are problems relevant to a lot of partitioning mechanisms. One problem is scalability to many cores. How do you actually scale it? And we'll talk about that. What if you have non-convex cores? Basically, utility is not decreasing. You have different kinds of utility functions, like a step function. How do you handle that? And what about the time complexity of partitioning? This is low for two cores because the number of possible partitions is a similar number of ways. But what if you have more cores? Possible partitions basically increase exponentially with cores. The paper has some calculations. But if you have 8 cores and a 32-way cache, the number of possible partitions you need to evaluate becomes quickly 15.4 million. Now, how do you design that partitioning algorithm? Well, it's a bit difficult. So we'll talk about how to do that. Problem is basically MP hard. You need a scalable partitioning algorithm. There actually was an algorithm that was proposed by Harald Sthoen at IBM. This is the same person who proposed computation in memory in the 1970s, by the way. He looked at optimal partitioning of memory on a block basis. And he has a greedy algorithm. Basically, you allocate one block to the application that has the maximum utility for that block. And you repeat until all blocks in the cache are allocated on a block-by-block basis. Anyway, if you basically have pathological behavior for non-convex curves, as I'll show you earlier. Let's take a look at, you may think that this is a good algorithm, right? You look at the next block. You always look at a block granularity. Who benefits most if I allocate this block to them? Right, that's the key question you're asking. Now, that may be good, but there is a problem with it. Any thoughts? This works well if your curves are convex, right? Your utility is all, you have a good curve there, you get good utility all the time. But what if utility is a step function? An application doesn't benefit for a long time. You keep allocating. But at some point, you allocate 15 ways and it benefits a lot because now it's working, starts fitting in the cache. That application, you shouldn't really look at the next block. You should really look at next 15 ways or something like that. That's the problem with block-based algorithm, fine granularity algorithms like this. Now, this is basically showing it pictorially. It considers benefits only from the immediate block. As a result, it fails to exploit large gains from looking ahead. What is looking ahead? Basically, let's simulate this block-based partitioning algorithm. This is the number of blocks assigned, and this is the number of misses you get for application A and B. So A has a nice curve that's convex. B doesn't have that nice curve. It has a step function over here. A greedy algorithm would keep allocating blocks to A and never allocate something to B because B doesn't benefit from the next block, right? Whereas you could get a much better result if you do a little bit look ahead. And the idea of look ahead is it's not just for next block, but consider marginal utility for all possible allocations into the future. And select the application that has the maximum value for this marginal utility. Okay? And allocate as many blocks as required to get that maximum marginal utility. And repeat until all blocks are assigned. Let's take a look at this with the same example where a greedy algorithm assigns a cache block, all the cache blocks to A. Now we want to assign some blocks to B because B actually reduces its miss rate a lot more, right? If you look at it a little bit. The first iteration of the algorithm, you figure out what is the best marginal utility you can get for A. It's really 10 misses for one block, right? Because you get a reduction of 10 misses if you give it one block. And that's the best you can get if you look at all possible allocations. Whereas if you look at B, if you allocate it 3 blocks, you get a reduction of 80 misses. Right? So marginal utility of B is actually much higher than marginal utility of A if you look a little bit farther ahead. Think about allocating more blocks than just one, which means that you do this allocation. You allocate 3 ways to B. And then in the next 5 iterations, marginal utility of B now becomes really 0. Because however many blocks you allocate, you don't get any benefit anymore. Whereas marginal utility of A remains as 10. So you keep allocating to A. And you get a much better cache partition by looking ahead. OK, you can read the paper for the time complexity of this. And it's waste square. It's quadratic with the number of ways, which is not that bad, actually. Which may be still difficult to implement in hardware. OK, so what is the benefit of this? Basically, it gives you good benefit. It performs similarly to evaluating all possible partitions. Right? Remember, we're not evaluating all possible partitions here. We're just looking at the marginal utility. OK. So let's take a look at the advantages and disadvantages of this kind of partitioning over LRU. Basically, these are the two key advantages. It improves system throughput, clearly, and better utilizes the shared cache. Any other advantage? Thoughts? I cannot think of any other. But there are a bunch of disadvantages. Clearly, complexity is one. You give up a lot, you give up simplicity. But there are also fairness. Is this an algorithm, fair algorithm? Does it provide quality of service? It's good to think about it. It actually doesn't. Because if you have an application that's benefiting a little bit more than another application, you keep allocating waste to the application that's benefiting more. And you never allocate waste to the application that benefits less. Right? So in terms of fairness, this is not a good idea. It's good for throughput, reducing miss rate, but fairness, it doesn't. That's why we're going to talk about fairness next. So there are also limitations, right? Scalability. It's actually a limitation of way partitioning. If you're partitioning your cache on the granularity of ways, you're limited to the number of ways you have. Right? If you have 32 ways, the maximum number of partitions you can have is 32. Right? And that's only assigning one way. So if you have 32 ways and 8 cores, well, you don't have a whole lot of leverage in terms of how you can partition your cache. And what if you have number of ways less than number of apps? Yeah, and that's usually the case if you have many core systems. Scalability issues, how do you compute utility? If you have caches that are distributed, how do you do that? You can think about it. And what if past behavior is not a good predictor of utility? This is always a problem with predictive mechanisms like this. So an implicit assumption that I didn't tell you is, OK, in the past, you see it may have been a good idea to allocate three ways to this. But in the future, is that the case also? Maybe there are better ways of predicting that. And people have developed mechanisms for phase prediction, for example. Can you predict the phase of an application and switch to a better allocation at the end of a phase? OK, let's move on to something that does provide fairness. Any question? OK. No. Just looking at it intently. That's good. OK. So hopefully it's clear that utility-based cache partitioning doesn't provide fairness. How do we provide fairness then? I'll give you one example again over here. One definition of fairness is to equalize the slowdowns of multiple threads sharing the cache. If you have multiple threads, somehow equalize the slowdown they're getting. And the idea in the paper that I'm going to very briefly describe is dynamically estimate the slowdown due to sharing and assign cache blocks to balance the slowdowns. And how do you figure out the slowdown? Well, we're going to talk about that a little bit when we talk about main memory. But one way is to approximate the slowdown with the change in miss rate. So if your miss rate triples, you can say, oh, I'm getting slowed down by 3x. Now, that may not be perfectly accurate. But that's something you can obtain more easily than the absolute performance slowdown, right? And this is the paper. This is actually one of the earlier papers that talks about fairness. I'll give you an example of how it operates, but not exactly how mechanisms are implemented. This is to make you think about how things may work. So let's say this is the miss rate that you have alone without sharing the cache. The first question that should come to your mind is, how do you actually get this miss rate? One way is to run the application alone for a while and figure it out. And this is exactly what that paper does. That's not a good idea in general, because that actually loses performance, because you're running the application alone for a while, right? You're not utilizing the multi-core. But assume that you got it somehow. In the first interval, you figure out what is the miss rate that you're getting when you're actually sharing the cache with some partition. And this is, let's say LRU. Or maybe let's say that's the partition. I don't know. Oh, yeah, that's the partition, yeah. You basically equally partition the cache, at least target. So this is what you get. At the end of the interval, you evaluate what is your slowdown. Miss rate shared divided by miss rate alone for program 1. Miss rate shared divided by miss rate alone for program 2. Here, this is 1. This is 3. Right? Basically, you guess, oh, this application slowed down by 3x, which means that maybe I should allocate more cache to processor 2, application 2. So you have a partition granularity. You increase the partition for processor 2 by taking up some space from processor 1. And then you do the same thing. In the next interval, you run with that partition. Now the miss rate of P2 reduces. Miss rate of P1 doesn't change. Now that's good. At the end, you evaluate slowdown again. This is still 1. Now this is 2. Well, you did better, but still, there, it's not fair, according to this definition of fairness, right? That's another question you should be asking. Is this a good definition of fairness, right? OK, basically, you allocate more to P2 by taking a little bit more from P1, and then run with that partition. Now you get something like this. Miss rate of P1 increases, P2 reduces very little. And the algorithm over here rolls back, so you can read the paper for more detail, but it goes back to the previous partition because it didn't gain much from doing so. Does that make sense? So you can actually devise different algorithms. So the idea of me showing this to you is to think about how would you actually enforce some sort of fairness. And a lot of the algorithms that have been proposed for fairness work this way. You have an interval, you figure out what is your slowdown within that interval for each application. You dynamically reallocate the resources at the end to balance the slowdowns, and then figure out what happens at the end of the next interval. And then you keep running that way. But for this to work well, clearly getting the miss rate that's while you're running together with other applications is relatively easy, right? You can figure that out by just counting how many misses you're getting. But the more difficult part is how do you get the miss rate when you're running alone? Because you're not running alone. You're always executing with different applications. OK. Let's take a look at the advantages and disadvantages of this approach. Well, I guess the disadvantages came together also, but that's OK. Now you can reduce starvation this way, right? An application cannot starve another application because you're providing some sort of fairness. Of course, there's a caveat always. And that caveat is you need to estimate your alone miss rate well for this to work. If you're completely off in that estimation, you cannot do that. So this gets better average throughput. You can look at the paper. And it actually does block granularity partitioning in this case. So you can give one block at a time in this case. Because there's nothing that limits this approach to way partitioning. In utility-based cache partitioning, you need way partitioning, because ways are very intimately tied to the misestimation mechanism that you have. Disadvantages and limitations, we already talked about this. Alone miss rate estimation can be incorrect. And think about how to do that. Again, is this scalable to many cores? That's always a problem, actually, with many cache partitioning mechanisms. How do you scale it to many, many cores? Is this a good fairness metric? Maybe, maybe not. This is something that people have argued for decades and decades. What's a good fairness metric in operating systems also? And there's no end to the argument. One of the most recent schedulers for Linux is this thing called CFQ or something like it, completely fair queuing scheduler. That has one definition of fairness, actually, and people have argued why that's not fair for a long time also. But you can take a look at it. Does this provide performance isolation in the cache? Does it? Well, not really, right? Again, you're very dependent on the miss rate estimations. If that's not correct, then you don't get that isolation. Okay, any questions? So I've given you two approaches for cache sharing, hardware-based. Both of them are hardware-based approaches. You can imagine many, many other approaches. And existing processors actually, the Haswell implements a variant of that ICS paper that I mentioned earlier. So if you want to take a look at it, you can actually look at the Haswell documentation too. But let's switch gears a little bit, and let's look at another way of doing this kind of partitioning. And that's software-based. And we do have control at the software level, even if hardware provides nothing to us. So basically, we're going to assume no hardware support, demand-based cache sharing, or free-for-all sharing, LRU placement. How can the OS best utilize the cache? There are actually several approaches. I'm not going to talk about the first one as much. You can actually schedule the threads such that you're aware of the sharing. What does this mean? Schedule the workloads such that play nicely with each other in the cache. Don't put a streaming workload with a workload that has very good locality, for example, if you know that information. Or put workloads whose working sets somehow together fit in the cache. This clearly requires some sort of profiling of application behavior at the operating system level and doing scheduling. And there have been papers related to this. You can take a look at them. And this is another general approach, scheduling threads such that you get better utilization of resources. There's nothing magic about caches here. It's also true for memory bandwidth. I'll talk about something else, cache sharing aware page coloring. And here, we're going to partition the cache based on using the virtual memory mappings that the operating system has control of. basically the operating system will dynamically monitor miss rate over an interval and change virtual to physical mappings to minimize the miss rate in the entire system by trying out different partitions. Now you can see that this is kind of similar to utility-based cache partitioning, except it's done at the software level, right? Well, let's take a look at it. So these are actually two papers that discuss it. One of them in the recommended paper list. They actually give results from real systems. You can do static cache partitioning as well as dynamic cache partitioning in a shared cache. For example, you can predetermine the amount of cache blocks allocated to each program at the beginning of its execution and divide the shared cache to multiple regions and partition the regions through OS page address mapping. And we'll take a look at that. The second one is doing this dynamically, adjusting the cache quota among processes dynamically. And this requires something called recoloring, and we'll see the cost of that in a little bit. Basically, you need to dynamically change the process's cache usage through OS-based address mapping. Again, assume no hardware support. Hardware doesn't provide any support. LRU is what you get in the cache. OK, so what's page coloring? Has anyone heard of this? Yes, and some. In 447, if you've taken 447, you've definitely heard it. But basically, you can think of physical memory divided into colors, and colors mapping to different cache sets. And this is just one example over here. You can have different colors. And colors, basically, an index in the cache has all the same colors. And you can have multiple different regions with different colors. Cache partitioning means you need to ensure two threads are allocated pages of different colors. So if you want to partition the cache between thread A and thread B like this, you allocate two colors to thread A and two colors to thread B. Make sense? So how do you do that? Well, operating system has control over those colors, in a sense. So if you look at a virtual address, you have this virtual page number and the page offset. OS translates this address to a physical page number. Page offset remains the same. And the cache address is interpreted out of this physical address, at least at the shared cache level, right? At the L1 cache level, you can actually have virtual parts. But let's look at the shared cache level. Basically, you have cache tag, set index, and block offset. Block offset is usually smaller than the page offset. So think of 4 kilobyte page, 64 byte block. Now, operating system has some control over the set index, right? Operating system can say, oh, I'm going to choose to allocate a physical page number to this application that maps to this set in the cache. And that's exactly what these colors are in the cache. The set index really determines your page colors in the cache. The set index, the bits in the set index that are controllable by the operating system. Make sense? And let's say you have, it really depends on how much overlap you have in this. Let's say this is only 4 bits. That means you can have at most 16 colors. If this is 10 bits, well, you can have 2 to the 10 colors, right? Different colors, potentially, because you can have 2 to the 10 different places. OK, basically, physically, let me go over this very quickly again. Physically indexed caches are divided into multiple regions. This is the cache. And all cache lines in a physical page are cached in one of those regions, colors. And the OS can control the page color of a virtual page through this address mapping by selecting a physical page with a specific value in its page color bits. This makes sense, right? This is actually very classic page coloring. You can actually do it on your own in the operating system. Some operating systems already employ page coloring. So how do you do the static page cache partitioning if you are able to do this page coloring? Basically, you can bin the physical pages according to their page color, where they map in the cache, which indices they map, and allocate these to different applications. And now the question is, how much do you allocate to different applications? The upside now, there's an upside and a downside. The upside is you partition the shared cache between two processes, right? The downside is it comes with main memory space partitioning also. And people have recently proposed, how do you actually decouple these things from each other? Because you're coloring not only the indices in the cache, but also coloring the pages in main memory. So if you allocate, if you restrict to allocate only some physical pages with some bits to an application, you're really restricting your allocation in main memory as well. Right? That's the downside of this approach. So if you need more memory, well, too bad. You need to violate the coloring policy that you have, because if you need more memory, probably you don't want to have another page fault for this application. That's a lot more costly than a cache miss. Okay. Now it makes sense, right? So how do you do the static partitioning? We'll take a look at the partitioning algorithm. These are now mechanisms. But let's take a look at dynamic partitioning and its costs. Let's assume that we have allocated three different colors to this application. And how do you do that? Basically, you can organize pages of a process as linked lists by their colors. And you can guarantee even distribution across the colors. Because ideally, you would like to evenly distribute your pages across the colors such that you get good conflict behavior in the cache. How do you do that? Basically, while you allocate pages, you kind of do round robin, something like this. You can do better profiling, but we're not going to go into that. OK, now you have three colors allocated to this application, and it's allocated all these pages. If you want to repartition your cache and want to allocate one more color to this application, what do you need to do? Well, one thing you could say is, I'm going to allocate the new pages from here. But what if the application is not going to allocate more pages? That's a problem. So what this paper does, and what you may decide to do, is repartition, right? Pick some pages over here, do recoloring, allocate the page in new color, copy the memory contents, and free the old page. That's a lot of movement of data, as you can see, right? But this is the cost of dynamic partitioning at the operating system level, if you would like to do this. And now you rebalanced it. Now you copied four pages over here. OK? Does that make sense? So that's the downside of not having fine-grained hardware control. Hardware control, fine-grain. If it was fine-grain, you do weight partitioning like we've described, right? That's easier. That's a lot simpler. You don't move a lot of data. Here, you have to move data. OK, so let's take a look at one possible algorithm to do this dynamic partitioning. And this is the paper's algorithm. And I'm going to show you very quickly some results from that paper. And you can do this on a real system. Basically, you can initially partition the cache as 8 colors to this application and 8 colors to another application in a dual core system, and then run the current partition, figure out its miss rates, total miss rate, let's say, or total hit rate. And then you also try one epoch, one interval, where you look at the neighboring partitions, where you reduce the colors allocated to one process and increase the colors allocated to another process and do vice versa. And compare all three approaches, right? Compare the hit rate of this, hit rate of this, hit rate of this. Now, that's a lot of overhead to begin with, right? Because you need to move pages, actually, to be able to do this well. And then you choose the next partitioning with the best policy metric, best metric. Let's say the one that minimizes the miss rate or maximizes the hit rate. And then you keep doing this as you run. And this is a simple algorithm, as you can see. And even with this simple algorithm, we will see performance benefits, according to this paper, at least. And these are the, you can read the paper, look at the results. And the paper evaluated both static and dynamic cache partitioning approaches on a real system. I guess this is a relatively old system right now, because it's a paper from 2008. And their goal was to minimize combined miss rate. And you can see that there are some cases where static partitioning is better than dynamic partitioning, mainly due to the overhead of dynamic partitioning. And there are other cases where dynamic partitioning, even though it has a lot of overhead, it outperforms the static partitioning significantly. And overall, they've actually shown a lot of benefits, significant benefits from partitioning. I guess you can see it from here. There are some application groups that have like a 30% performance improvement with static partitioning. And you can see the cache parameters over here. It's a shared 4 MB L2 cache. And I think they had 16 colors. OK. Now let's take a look at the advantages and disadvantages of this kind of approach, at least software versus hardware, not necessarily OS-based. But you can think of the OS-based also. So big advantage of software is no need to change hardware, right? You can implement it today. That doesn't mean that it's the best partitioning mechanism you get, but you could do it. And it's easier to upgrade and change algorithms, right? You don't burn an algorithm into the hardware. It can be more flexible. What is the big disadvantage? At least with what I described earlier. Well, one is granularity, right? It's a huge granularity of partitioning. It's at the page granularity versus way or block granularity. The second is limited page colors, right? If you actually have limited page colors, you have reduced performance per application because you actually have limited physical memory space. And also, you can have reduced flexibility. If you have only four colors to partition, then you don't have a lot of flexibility in parts. This is similar to Waze, right? So you need to have a good number of colors to be able to do this partitioning across a large number of applications. And changing partition size has high overhead, especially with this kind of OS page mapping changes. And adaptivity is also slow in this case. Hardware can adapt every cycle, right? Possibly every cycle you can decide to repartition somehow, right? Whereas it's very difficult at the software level to do that, because even getting information takes a long time from hardware. And maybe not enough information is exposed to the software, right? How do you actually figure out the number of misses due to conflict? Maybe the number of misses, number of hits you get change because the application changes behavior, right? It's not because you have more conflicting misses. So these are good things to think about, the software versus hardware trade-offs. In a sense, if the flexibility of software algorithms is easier because you don't burn the algorithm into the hardware, but it also doesn't have a whole lot of flexibility because your granularity is so large. Any questions? Any thoughts? Are you ready to think about your new algorithm? OK. I guess before I move on to something else, actually, before we take a maybe short break, let me talk about one thing very quickly. I'll go back to the hardware approach, actually. And this, I'll call this private slash shared caching. And one example of this is this paper, Adaptive Spill Receive Caching. And the goal here is what I talked briefly earlier, somehow achieve the benefits of private caches, low latency, performance isolation, while sharing cache capacity across cores. How do you do that? We're not going to start with a shared cache. The starting point is the exact opposite. Start with a private cache design, because that can provide performance isolation nicely, but dynamically steal space from other cores that do not need their private caches, or that do not need portions of their private caches. I'm not going to talk about how to do this in detail, but I'll give you the motivation very quickly. Some caches can spill data to other cores' caches dynamically. So why are private caches good? Basically, it avoids the need for the shared interconnect within the cache, right? You know, a core can directly access its cache. There's no interconnect that it needs to go through to access different banks over here. You can still bank it. As a result, you get fast latency. You can make this connection very high bandwidth. You can actually tightly couple it with the core. Whereas it's much more difficult to do that with a shared cache, because that, there needs to be an interconnect that connects the cores to the caches. And you get performance isolation over here, because this core can now access this cache directly. The problem with private caches is when one core needs more cache and another core has spare cache, this private cache doesn't share the capacity. So we're going to fix that very briefly. There was this proposal in ISCA 2006 that is the first one of the first proposals, actually. It's called cooperative caching. Cooperative caching has been used in distributed systems, actually. The idea comes from distributed systems. In a distributed system, you have this node, and you want to cache the data of this node and another node because this data doesn't fit here. Well, you cooperate. That's the idea. The idea over here is very similar over here. Basically, when you're doing an eviction, this cache, when you're doing an eviction, you flip a coin, with some probability, send it to a neighboring cache. With some probability, drop it, evict it. So it's a probabilistic mechanism over here. And performance, so you can actually read this, this adaptive split receive paper to have a good comparison. But one of the issues here is performance may depend on the parameter. How do you determine that probability, right? It's kind of a cute idea, actually, right? But how do you determine that probability? Maybe it needs to be determined on a per application basis. And in this case, all caches spill as well as receive. That may or may not be a good idea, right? Why? Because if an application has a working set that's bigger than the private cache, maybe you don't want to receive from other applications, because you're already using your cache really well. You should be spilling. So basically, if you look at this paper, This paper classifies each cache as either a spiller or a receiver, but not both, depending on how well it's utilizing the cache. And lines from the spiller cache are spilled to one of the receivers. Then the question is, which receiver? Maybe the neighbor. It now depends on how far away your receiver is, perhaps, right? And evicted lines from the receiver cache are discarded. Basically, if you're a receiver cache, if you're not spilling, that means once you evict the cache line, drop it on the floor. And now the key question becomes, how do you determine who is a spiller and who is a receiver? And who is your particular receiver? Right. And maybe do you have multiple receivers? I'm not going to answer those questions, but you can actually read that paper. So similar mechanisms actually have been employed in IBM Power 7, I believe, even though there is not a whole lot of detail in how those caches operate. Okay. Any questions? Do you think this is a good time to take a break? OK. So let's take a break, because we're going to switch gears a little bit and talk about how to efficiently utilize caches. Is a 5-minute break good? Let's be back at 43. Or I guess 13 at India time. 3 or 13, so let's get started. So we're going to talk about efficient cache utilization. I'm going to talk about some ideas. There's a lot of work in this area, clearly. Efficient cache utilization is important even when you have single core, right? You want to best utilize the cache space. You don't want to put in cache stuff that's not going to be reused. Again, you don't want to put in cache stuff that's not going to be beneficial to the application. So people have looked at how they efficiently utilize caches. And people have figured out very early on that LRU is not a good algorithm. It's good, but then there are better algorithms, because sometimes you want to, especially if you're streaming through data, people figured out that LRU is not a good approach, because you put everything into the cache. Sometimes you want to bypass the cache, for example. These are called scan-like patterns. How do you actually eliminate the pollution caused by scans? But this becomes a much, much bigger problem when you have multiple cores sharing the cache, because cache space becomes much more valuable, right? In fact, modern GPUs actually incorporate caches. There used to be a time where you didn't have a whole lot of caches in the shader cores and GPUs. But modern GPUs now incorporate caches because they want to exploit the locality as much as possible, such that they save the memory bandwidth. They don't need to access memory as much. Then the key question becomes, how do you efficiently utilize those GPU caches? But the problem is similar in any cache. Oh, OK. So I'll talk about some papers, but these are by no means the only papers. I'll talk about some of them, because they're some of the recent ideas. So why is cache utilization important? One is memory latency is large, and the queuing latencies are also actually increasing over here when you have contention. And the second is there is more contention because of more cores. So one thing that people have looked at in the past is reuse behavior of different cache blocks. Different cache blocks have different reuse behavior. I've already given you an example earlier. Let's take a look at some more concrete examples, because this will lead to some examples of mechanisms. You have this access sequence, ABC, clearly has good reuse, right? Whereas the other ones don't have good reuse. So we can classify them as high reuse and low reuse. One question that should come to your mind is, how do you actually classify these blocks? Now, clearly, the first time you see the block, you may have no idea, right? Maybe you need to see it again. Maybe you need it again. How many times do you need to see it to decide that it's high reuse, right? Or maybe you get some application hints. Actually, in modern ISAs, there are hints, right? x86 ISA, for example, has non-temporal loads. The programmer can say, oh, this load instruction should be non-temporal, meaning it shouldn't be cached in the L1 cache, because it's not going to be, it doesn't have good temporal locality. You can actually specify that. But we'll talk about another way of identifying it. So ideally, in the cache, you would like to have only these red blocks, right? High reuse blocks. You'd like to get rid of every other block, or not even cache the low reuse blocks. So we'll talk about two problems. And cache pollution is one problem. The definition of this is low reuse blocks evict high reuse blocks. That's the idea of pollution. Let's take a look at it. Let's say we are using LRU policy. If you have this access pattern. You keep evicting the red blocks. Blue blocks keep evicting the red blocks. So how do you prevent this cache pollution? One idea, there have been many mechanisms related to this. I'll give you the high-level ideas. Predict the reuse behavior of the missed blocks. Insert these low reuse blocks at the LRU position. So basically, figure out these blue blocks. Don't insert them at the high position, because if you insert them at the higher position, they're going to stay in the cache for a long time, right? So let's take a look at this idea. You figure out the blue blocks and insert them at the LRU position in the set. The next blue block, insert at the LRU position. Now blue blocks keep evicting each other instead of touching the red blocks. As a result, you get most of what you want in the cache. That's one idea. That's one way to eliminate cache pollution. The other problem is cache thrashing. That's a different problem, actually. Don't confuse these two with each other. Here, high reuse blocks evict each other. Basically, you get good reuse, but your cache is not big enough to capture that reuse. One example is this, basically. You have this, but your cache is small. As a result, you do this. You keep evicting high reuse blocks, but then you need, when you need A, it's not in the cache because it's already evicted. Right? So how do you actually fix this problem? Well, this way, by inserting a block at the MRU position with a very low probability, you can actually keep the blocks, most of the blocks in the cache, prevent thrashing. Why? Let's take a look at an example. Basically, this is your cache. You keep inserting most blocks at the LRU. Now what's happening is a fraction of working set always stays in the cache. You're not disturbing it. And that's a good way of preventing cache thrashing in general. Try to keep the contents as constant as possible, assuming you have higher reuse in those contents. That's the idea. This is called the bimodal insertion policy. This is actually one of the recent seminal papers in the area also. It's called Adaptive Insertion Policies for High Performance Caching, also by Qureshi. He's done a lot of work in this area. But that's the key idea. Later, actually, some of the recent processors implement what is a variant of what is called reference interval prediction. A lot of those ideas are actually based on these earlier papers. If you look at them, you'll find them. OK, how do you handle both pollution and thrashing? Ideally, if you design a cache, you don't want pollution in it, and you don't want thrashing. You would like to mitigate both of them. So you need to address both of them concurrently. For cache pollution, it's clear that we need to control the number of blocks inserted with high priority into the cache. And for cache thrashing, you need to distinguish high. Actually, this should be the other way around. This is a mistake. Remap this in your head. Right? Cache thrashing, cache pollution. I'll do this, Nandita will remind me. OK, so reuse prediction. How do you do the reuse prediction? Basically, you get a missed block. Before inserting into the cache, you need to say, oh, this is high reuse or low reuse. One good way could be keeping track of the reuse behavior of every cache block in the system. Well, the problem is it has high storage overhead, right? And maybe lookup latency. Now, if the software gives you that information, that may be a good idea, but that doesn't mean that the software figured it out correctly also, right? Software may think it's high reuse, but depending on the input set, basically the software profile may not be correct. It may mismatch what's happening dynamically. So we'd like to ideally do this dynamically. And people have approached this in many different ways. Actually, there are early papers in early 1990s that look at, for example, program counters. If this program counter is fetching this block, usually it's low reuse or high reuse. Why does this make sense? Maybe, for example, you have a load that's streaming through memory, scanning through memory. That may be low reuse, right? That's exactly the reason why Intel has non-temporal load instructions. You can mark that. Or memory region. The blocks that are touched that are in this memory region are usually high reuse. Why may this make sense? Well, if you think about the application level, if you have a database index in this memory region, and if you keep accessing that database, that index is high reuse probably, compared to a lot of data in the database that you once in a while touch. So you can actually think about program level reasons why this may make sense. And past works have actually looked at that. I haven't written all of the past works here because there are a lot of them. But basically, What they do is they group the blocks based on program counter or based on memory region, let's say. They learn the group behavior, high reuse, low reuse, and they predict the reuse. When they see this program counter again, they say, oh, the block that I'm going to fetch is going to be high reuse versus low reuse. Now, this may make sense. This amortizes a lot of the overhead. Instead of keeping track on a per block basis, you're really keeping track on a bigger region basis or program counter basis. Now, there are issues with this also. Same group doesn't mean that same reuse behavior in some cases. And yeah. So how do you do the per block reuse prediction? The paper that I'm going to very briefly touch upon is going to do this per block reuse prediction. Because that actually, grouping is not always good. Grouping reduces your storage cost. In that sense, it's good. But if the group doesn't behave exactly the same way, that reduces your accuracy also in terms of this reuse prediction. So one idea is use the recency of eviction to predict reuse. And actually, there are multiple works that have looked at this. So this is the time a block is evicted. If the block is needed very quickly after eviction, oh, maybe you made a mistake by evicting this block. Right? Maybe it was high reuse. If the block is needed a really long time after its eviction, oh, maybe this is low reuse anyway. So it was a good idea to evict it. So basically, the time of used after eviction could be an indicator of reuse behavior. And the paper takes advantage of this. It's called the evicted address filter over here. You have a cache over here. This is a set, if you look at it, MRULRU. And you have this filter that keeps the addresses of recently evicted blocks. So when you evict a block, you take the address, you append it at this evicted address filter. And when you get a miss, you first check if that block is in the evicted address filter, if it was recently evicted. Now, if you get a hit in that evicted address filter, oh, you say, oh, I made a mistake by evicting it. This was a high reuse, so I'm going to insert it at the MRU position so that it remains in the cache. Remember, if you insert something in the MRU position, it takes a long time for it to trickle down to the LRU position, so it remains a lot longer in the cache. Whereas if you insert something in the LRU position, the next time something else gets into the cache, you're going to evict it for that set. So if you miss in the evicted address filter, well, after this, you need to remove the stuff from the evicted address, but you can read the paper. If you miss, you take the block address, access the evicted address filter. If you miss in the evicted address filter, that means you didn't recently evict the block. So you predict that it's low reuse, so you put it into LRU position. That's the idea of the evicted address filter. That's kind of a cute idea, right? Now, one of the downsides of the idea is for a block to be inserted at the MRU position, you need to see it twice. You need to miss on it twice, right? That's actually one downside. But anyway, so how do you actually implement this? Implementation is actually a really important thing. You can come up with crazily complex cache mechanisms, and you can bet that they're not going to be implemented. But the simple implementations always win. Yes? So in a sense, it's similar, right? Victim cache, the idea of victim cache is you have an evicted block goes to a small buffer, such that if you need it soon after, you're going to hit on it. Here, it's not the data block that you're keeping. It's the address of the data. So it's only the addresses. Okay. In fact, it's also called the victim tag stores. These are tags for the victims. OK, so how do you implement it? Well, basically, if you actually have full addresses, you have large storage overhead, you have associative lookups, you need to figure out where. And the realization is that this doesn't need to be 100% accurate, because this prediction is not 100% accurate anyway. Right? So can we somehow implement this evicted address filter in a nicer way? And the idea in this paper is to use a Bloom filter to implement the filter. This leads to low storage overhead and energy. You guys know what a Bloom filter is? No? Oh, OK. I guess I'll cover it very quickly. This is Burton Bloom's paper, 1970, CACM, Communications of the ACM. You can take a look at it. But basically, a Bloom filter provides an approximate representation of a set compactly. it's approximate, because you can have the answer. Basically, if you insert something into this approximate representation, you may never have inserted something, but the Bloom filter may tell you, oh yes, you've inserted it. Okay, basically it's a bit vector that looks like this, and you have a set of hash functions. So let's take a look at how it operates first. So remember what we want to get. We want to be able to insert addresses into it, and then later we want to be able to query whether an address is present into it. So ideally, if you have full address tags, you store all of the addresses that you've inserted, and then you search. We don't want that search, and we don't want that huge storage of addresses. Instead, we are going to compactly represent that set of addresses as a bit vector. And then when we insert an address, we're going to set some bits. And the fact that those bits were set will represent the fact that you inserted that address. And later, when you query, you go to the same bits. And if you hit on those bits, if all of the bits are set, that means that the address was inserted. OK, that's the idea. So you have hash functions. To be able to do that, you need to go through hash functions. Let's say we want to insert x. You go through two hash functions that map x by hashing the bits to two locations. You set those bits. Now you inserted x here. And then let's say you insert y, because you're evicting it. Now this goes through, again, the address goes through two hash functions. And you set those two bits. Y is inserted. Let's say you want to test x. You go through the same hash functions again. They map to those bits that x was mapped to before. And now one, they're both present. That means you hit in the Bloom filter. So Bloom filter tells, yes, it exists in me. X exists in me. Now let's say you want to test for z. Z we did not insert, remember. And it maps to a 1 over here. And it maps to a 0 over here. Now for an element to be declared as present, both of the bits need to be 1. It's not 1, which means that Bloom filter says you did not. I don't have z inside. Now you can imagine. You can see why having two hash functions is good, right? Because if you had only h1, the Bloom filter would have told you, oh, I have z, even though you've never inserted z into it. That's one of the advantages of having multiple hash functions and multiple bits. Aliasing is higher with a single hash function. Of course, how you design the hash function is an important question. OK, let's say we want to test w. You go through both of the hash functions, and unluckily, both of them map to two bits that are set earlier. Then the Bloom filter tells you, yes, I have w in me. But we've never inserted w, right? This is called a false positive. And that's one disadvantage of Bloom filters. That's why it's exactly why Bloom filters are approximate. And this bit was set by x, insertion of x, and this bit was set by the insertion of y. As a result, you got this false positive. Make sense? So if you can tolerate false positives, this is a really nice data structure. And in this case, we can tolerate false positives, right? The evicted address filter, we insert some things. And let's say we test the evicted address filter, and the filter tells us, oh, I have the result. You actually inserted this block before. All we do it is insert that block into the cache at high priority at the MRU position. Maybe that's wrong. Maybe that's correct, though. We don't know for sure. OK, so how do you do the removal in a Bloom filter? Well, if you actually remove a bit, you can actually remove multiple addresses, right? Because there is no one-to-one mapping between the bits and the addresses. Multiple addresses can map to a single bit. So actually, you cannot remove a single element easily from a Bloom filter. So that operation is not possible. But you can clear the entire Bloom filter clearly. So it has advantages and disadvantages. And actually, there are really interesting space-time trade-offs. I think Burton Bloom's paper was titled Space-Time Trade-offs in Hash Coding, or something like that. That's not exactly right. There should be something else in that title. OK, so how do you implement EAF using a Bloom filter? Basically, you insert the evicted block address by setting some bits. When you actually miss a block, you test and remove it present, but you cannot do the remove here. And you remove the block when the evicted address is full. But we're not going to be able to perform these remove operations. So instead, we're not going to remove it, but we're going to clear the bloom filter when it's full. So you kind of start out from a clean slate. That may be a good idea anyway in a lot of the mechanisms, because again, this is all a predictive mechanism, right? Once in a while, it may be good to forget what you learned and restart. OK. So it turns out this actually greatly reduces the storage overhead. And the storage overhead of those bits is only 1.5% compared to the cache size. So final design looks like this, basically. You have a cache, you have a bloom filter, evicted address filter, and a counter of how many things you've inserted. Upon an eviction from the cache, you insert the address into the filter the way we described, setting some bits. You increment the counter. And on a cache miss, you test if address is present in the filter. If it is, that means that you've evicted it prematurely, in a sense. You should have inserted at MRU, so you inserted at MRU. Otherwise, you insert it with the bimodal insertion policy. I said LRU earlier, but it's good to have a bimodal insertion policy that we've discussed earlier. What does bimodal insertion policy do? Remember, it tries to prevent cache thrashing, right? With low probability, insert at the MRU position. With a very high probability, insert at the LRU position. OK, and finally, when the bloom filter becomes full, which means that the counter reaches a maximum that's predefined, you clear the filter and the counter and restart. So there are several advantages to it. This is relatively simple to implement. It doesn't modify the cache structure internally. It's relatively hopefully easy to design and verify. And hopefully, it works with other techniques. So replacement policy is kind of independent of this, right? Because there's nothing that talks about the replacement policy over here. And I'll summarize the performance. You can take a look at the paper for more detail. But these are actually proposals that people have looked at for a while. For example, this is misregion-based caching. You group the regions based on high reuse versus low reuse. And if you get an address within that region that is marked as high reuse or that you learn to be as right reuse, you insert with high probability versus low probability. So if you look at this, there is performance improvement to be gained. And performance improvement increases with number of cores. And some of these are actually pretty competitive, if you look at it. But EAF also improves performance. So I'll let you look at the paper for more detail. So if you come up with fascinating cache ideas, make them implementable. That's important. OK, how much time do we have? We still have some time. Any questions? So that's one example of a state-of-the-art caching policy for you. If we wanted to talk about caching policies that are published in literature, that would take an entire course, probably. There's this joke in the architecture community that at some point, ISCA, the major conference in architecture, was called International Symposium on Computer Architecture, right? But it's also called International Symposium on Cache Architecture. That's changed a lot. It's much less so that way today, because there are many, many open problems in the field. But these are still important, you know. OK, let's take a look at something else, cache compression, because this is one example of how to actually minimize the redundancy or minimize the waste that you have in the cache. And cache compression actually can benefit other things, right? If you compress, you use less bandwidth in memory also. And you can apply it in many different levels. For example, you can think of a variable length ISA as a compressed ISA, right? Or it's a fixed length ISA as a not so compressed ISA. Okay, but okay, what is the motivation? Basically, there's significant redundancy in data. And you can see it over here, lots of zeros over here. The key question is, how do we exploit this? So cache compression can help. It can provide the effect of a larger cache without making the cache physically larger. So basically, let's assume that you have an L2 cache that's compressed. That's the uncompressed cache, sorry. Now, if you have a compressed cache, when you hit, you need to go through decompression. So clearly, there is one disadvantage. Your latency increases because you need to decompress, right? So low complexity decompression becomes important. And then after that, you have uncompressed cache, and you can operate on it. I guess you could, if you're imaginative, you can think of, why don't we operate on compressed data, right? Well, we don't have good algorithms to operate on compressed data today, at least. So there are several key requirements for this to be successful. One is it needs to be fast, because decompression latency is clearly on the critical path, of access, right? It needs to be simple, as always. Avoid complex hardware chains. And you want to, of course, get good compression ratio in general. Because if you don't get good compression ratio, the overhead may not be tolerable. So let's cover some of these mechanisms. I'm going to go through this really quickly, because these are some example mechanisms people have proposed. Zero compression. So people have figured out that actually a lot of the memory is full of zeros. And this kind of makes sense, right? You zero out a lot of the pages to begin with. For example, the existing operating system, all of the operating systems that I know of, whenever they deallocate or allocate a page, they zero out the page for privacy reasons, mainly, actually. For example, the Windows has a zero list, zero page list that it maintains. But basically, you can specially treat the zeros and encode them. If your page is zero, for example, you don't need to actually store the page, right? Almost. If your cache line is zero, you just need one bit to encode that cache line, zero or not. Now, this is great. It's easy to decompress. Complexity is low. Compression ratio may not be good, right? Because clearly, not your entire memory is zeros. There's frequent values. The idea over here is you figure out what are the frequently occurring values. Let's assume your cache blocks, right? You encode, you figure out what are the frequently occurring values depending on some granularity. Your granularity could be a cache block. Your granularity could be 8 bytes. And you encode them specially. For example, 0 is a frequent value. 1 is a frequent value, at least at the 4-byte granularity. -1 turns out to be a frequent value, FFFFFF, right? And you can do this statically or dynamically, right? How do you figure out the frequent values? Becomes important. The downside now may become decompression latency may be high, actually, because you need to do a lookup, table lookup, to figure out decompress. And you can have variable length encoding of the cache lines. Think about it. Complexity can be high, but the compression ratio can be good, actually. If you have, let's say, lots of frequent values that are encoded, and if you use a good encoding mechanism like Huffman encoding, I'm throwing some terms. Do you guys know Huffman encoding? OK, good. At least most of you do. If not, you can look at my 447 lectures on ISAs. But basically, Huffman encoding tries to assign the smallest code words to the most frequently occurring values. If you do that, you get actually a very good compression ratio. Frequent pattern, I'm not going to go through this in detail, but this is more sophisticated than frequent value. It gets you better compression ratio. I'll talk about this algorithm just to give you an example of a simple algorithm. So let's take a look at some data patterns in real applications. So zero values are common. Now we can ask why they're common. Initialization, you can have a lot of sparsity in data, sparse matrices. You can have null pointers. Right? All of those are zeros. Right? Repeated values are also common. For example, common initial values or adjacent pixels, if you look at video, you have a lot of repetition in the adjacent values. Narrow values are also common. Well, one example of this is you can have a large integer, 4 bytes, but your values that you store in that integer are never greater than what you could encode with 3 bits. Right? In this case, it's not 3 bits. Well, I guess it's close enough. Or other patterns. For example, pointers to the same memory region, they share the top bits. Right? In fact, other people have taken advantage of it to identify pointers. If you have the addresses, if the top bits match, well, then those could be pointers. Right? Here, the bottom bits change, but the top bits remain the same. So how common are these patterns? This is from the paper, Bayes Delta Immediate Compression paper that I referenced earlier. But basically, these are spec applications and maybe some others. I cannot see. But zero values are common in some applications. You can look at one application that has all zeros in the cache, for example. This may be the phase of application that actually stores zeros. But you have repeated values and other patterns. You can take a look at it. So what is the common in all of these patterns? And people have observed this also for other reasons. But the common thing is they have low dynamic range. Differences between values are significantly smaller than the values themselves. Right? It's also called narrow values, in a sense. People actually optimized, observed this. And you can actually store only narrow values in the register file, for example. We're going to do something similar, taking advantage of it. The key idea of this encoding, this compression mechanism, is called Bayes delta. You encode a base address and encode all of the values as deltas, differences from that base base value. Does that make sense? It's pretty simple, right? This is the base, and you can choose the, let's say this is your cache line. You divide into 4-byte chunks. The first 4-byte, you say, oh, this is my base. And everything else, including the first one, is encoded as deltas from that base. Now, how do you pick the base? There's a trade-off there. Maybe this is not the best base to pick, but it's the easy base to pick, clearly. Now your encoding is only 12 bytes, right? Which is 20 bytes less than your cache block. So you can save a lot of space. Quickly, this is fast. Decompression is now fast, right? You can think of what it takes to decompress this. You take the base value and add each byte to it. And you can do it in parallel. It's really a vector addition. Right? And simple hardware, and it has a good compression ratio. So can we do better than this? So not all patterns are clearly like that. What if you have mixed patterns like this? Well, you can see two bases over here, right? You cannot compress this with a single base, clearly, because this is hugely different from this one. But now you can have two bases. One base could be 0, one base could be this one, and you can encode the ones that are closer to 0 with this base, and you can encode the ones that are closer to this one with that base. Right? The upside is now you can have more cache lines that can be compressed. The problem is, how do you find these bases if they're arbitrary? Right? Now you're adding more complexity to the algorithm also. So you can have higher overhead. And you also need to store these bases somehow. As a result, you have higher overhead. So this is one example. You can, again, read the paper. But if you have multiple arbitrary bases, your compression ratio, and what does compression ratio mean in this case? Basically, 1.5 means a cache that's 1 megabyte looks like it's actually 1.5 megabytes. You can think of it that way. That's the way I like thinking of it, actually. You get the same capacity. OK. So how do you find the two bases efficiently? One of the key realizations in the paper is first base is the first element in the cache line. And the second base is set to 0, because zeros are so common. Implicitly, you say the second base is 0. Does that make sense? Now, you don't need to store that base. That's one advantage of it. That's why it's called immediate. You get better compression ratio, and you have simpler compression logic because of that. And better compression ratio comes from the fact that you don't actually store this base. Right? You can probably get better compression ratio if you had arbitrary bases, but now you need to store that arbitrary base. Right? Here you can implicitly say, oh, one of the bases is 0. OK, so what is the compression ratio that you get if you actually have arbitrary two bases and base delta immediate? It's actually base delta immediate is a little bit better, as you can see, but not always. And the compression ratio is around 1.5, I guess, which is not bad, right? OK, so you can, we have a few more minutes, but I'm going to go through this really quickly just to give you an idea of what it takes to actually build a compressed cache. Because there is complexity associated with it. That's one of the reasons, actually, why people are reluctant to do it. But we'll see if things change. But yeah. You need to have a decompressor design. For base delta immediate, that's low latency. So low latency is really important here. And compressor design, you can tolerate latency better here when you compress the data, because it's really not, compression is really not on the critical path, right? But at least not most of the time. But it needs to be low cost and complexity. And the cache organization, you need to modify the cache organization, because normally caches are not designed to store compressed data, right? Let's take a look at it. This is the compressor design. Decompressor design, it's basically a vector addition. And you can look at it. This is a compressor design. Basically, you need to try out different compression options. This becomes a little bit more complex. For example, zero compression, repeated value compression. How big is your base and how big are your deltas? You need to try it out. That's how you can figure out whether a cache line is compressible or not compressible. And these are all hardware blocks to try it out. And all cache compression mechanisms have something similar to this. And eventually, you need to have a compression selection logic, and you get the compressed cache line, or an indication that you cannot compress this cache with any of these, right? Which means that you need to have metadata in the tag store saying what kind of compression encoding that you have for this particular cache line, right? OK, so this is one example. Anyway, I'm not going to run through this. You can go through this. So what does the cache organization look like? This is actually the hardest part of a compressed cache, in my opinion. So if you have conventional two-way cache with 32-byte cache lines, it's simple, right? Your tag directly maps to your data. And that's the beauty of a cache design. Now, if you want compressed cache, well, first of all, you need to be able to, for the same amount of data storage that you have over here, you need to be able to store more cache blocks, not only two, which means that you need to be able to have more tags. Right? So a lot of the compressed caches actually double the tag store or make it even larger. Now you have twice as many tags. And each tag actually has some compression encoding bits. That tells you, is it compressed? What kind of compression algorithm is used? Dot, dot, dot. Now, your data store is not just cache blocks. You cannot just say, oh, this is my block. You need to kind of segment it, right? Because your cache blocks can be of different sizes. Some of them can be 8 bytes. Some of them, well, in this case, 4 bytes maximum. Some of them can be 1 byte, 2 byte, 3 bytes. Which means that you have a segment, and then you have pointers from these tag stores. And this tag, for example, says this block starts from S4, and it encompasses 3 segments after that. That's how you can do that. And this is actually a complicated part of the cache design. How do you actually do it? So if you come up with an easier to compress, easier design, let me know. OK, so the rest I'm going to skip. But basically, you can get pretty reasonable compression ratios. And if you have a compressed cache, you can significantly improve performance. One realization is that, in this particular paper at least, you can achieve the performance of twice the size, a cache with twice the size, which is pretty compelling. You don't need to build that cache. You just get that performance with very little overhead. And the overhead was 2.3% in the previous slide. And the reason is because your miss rate reduces clearly, right? This is depending on your cache size. And your benefit increases with multi-core workloads also. Again, I'm going to skip it. Well, why does it increase? Because you actually can have an application that's sensitive to cache size and can have another application that's very compressible. If you have these two applications, then you get actually benefits on both ends, right? Because you're relieving the cache pressure on this application that's actually sensitive to the cache size. And with multi-core, cache efficiency becomes a bigger problem also. OK, so I'm going to skip a lot of these. Well, I guess we're almost at the end. Any quick questions? OK, so I think I've covered a lot of. This is, again, one example. There are many, many examples of compressed caches and also how to do better utilization. This is just to give you some fundamental principles and examples of caching. But next time, for lecture 15, we're going to talk about, and that's going to be next Monday, we're going to talk about main memory sharing. We're going to talk about, again, examples of different approaches to do main memory resource management. But before that, on Wednesday, we'll have a guest lecture. Brian Black from AMD is going to talk about the 3D die stacking technology that they've built and they're working on. It should be pretty exciting. It should give you an industry perspective of an emerging memory technology that's almost emerged. Right? So it's good to, especially after the emerging memory technologies lectures, hopefully you will appreciate that. OK. I guess we're on time. So hopefully see you all on Wednesday.
Are there any real systems that use compressed caches?
Oh, that's a great question.
So maybe after